HarperCollins presents Lay Me to Rest by E.A. Clarke. Read by Katy Sobey. Prologue. July 2009. Anglesey, North Wales. Deep into the night, the rain fell unremittingly. I lay still, listening as it battered the windowpane, a steady, rhythmic thrum. Since childhood, to be safe and warm within had always been a source of comfort to me during a storm, knowing that the angry deluge could not penetrate the walls, that I was protected from even the harshest force of nature. But suddenly the pattern began to change. The sound was infiltrated by a slow, persistent scratching. As the noise increased in frequency and intensity, heart in mouth, I eased myself from the bed and crossed the room, hardly daring to draw breath as my trembling hand reached for the curtain. It was happening again. Cold terror surged through my veins as a pair of dark, glowering eyes met my own through the glass. As far as I was from the sight of the haunting, it would seem I was to be afforded no respite from her malevolent influence. I could feel her drawing closer. I staggered back from the window, my fear knowing no bounds, as I became suddenly enveloped by the familiar incipient chill. Inhaled the cloying, musky fragrance that I had come to dread. I opened my mouth to scream, but my throat was so dry that I could emit no more than a pitiful croak. It was inconceivable that I should find myself once more in this position. The previous disturbing encounters of the supernatural had been enough for anyone's lifetime. I had foolishly believed myself beyond harm here. That she should have followed me was unthinkable. Was there no refuge to which I could safely retreat? My hands shook violently as I tried desperately to turn the key in the lock, but it was stuck fast. I whipped round, panic-stricken now, my back pinned to the door. Through the gloom, I could still discern the menacing presence, initially a pallid shadow against the opposite wall, shapeless and pulsating. But I could feel her getting closer. Even without seeing clearly, I knew without doubt who she was. She exuded loathing and contempt, sentiments for which I had apparently become the sole focus. The walls seemed to close in on me now. My heart hammering, my breath came in shallow, rasping gasps as I watched the silhouette become ever clearer and more recognizable. The mocking eyes seemed to penetrate my very soul. Despite my best efforts, my feet remained inert. I felt the ground draw me like a magnet. Instinctively, I cradled my stomach. The room swam as she seemed to surround me. And then I knew no more. June 2009. Birmingham, West Midlands. I awoke, as had become the norm of late, cheeks wet, with fresh, hot tears spilling from my eyes, a choking sob rising in my throat. Each night the same recurring dream. Graham, standing at my bedside, expressionless, staring down at me. But the leaden weight of my arms left me unable to reach out to him, and he would fade away, leaving me alone once more. It was still dark, and only a sliver of lamplight could be seen through the narrow gap between the curtains. Shrugging the covers around my shoulders, I slid out of bed and walked across to the window. I stood, staring, for what seemed like an eternity, down at the deserted street below, absent-mindedly resting my hands on my swollen stomach. As daylight gradually began to creep through, I shifted my gaze, only to be met by my own disheveled reflection in the glass. I suppose, looking back, that this was the wake-up call I so desperately needed. The gaunt, transparent image staring back at me was virtually unrecognizable. For more than 3 months, I had lived like a recluse, neglecting my appearance and more or less subsisting on a diet of anything and everything that could be tipped straight from a can or packet, supplemented in the last fortnight, on the insistence of my younger sister, by Prozac, prescribed by a concerned locum who she had called to the house. In spite of my initial reluctance to take the tablets, having passed the first trimester of my pregnancy, I was assured that the risks to the baby were very small compared with the jeopardy to my own mental health if I remained untreated. As of the night of the 25th of February 2009, my status had become officially demoted from that of wife to widow. The title was something that did not sit well with me. It was a word I had always associated with women in their dotage who had shared a whole lifetime with their partners. At the ripe old age of 36, I was struggling to cope with this newfound and unwelcome identity thrust upon me by events beyond my control. Finding myself unexpectedly and miraculously pregnant just 7 weeks after my husband Graham's fatal accident left me reeling. My monthly cycle had always been predictably erratic, therefore another late period was nothing new. Nor had I experienced any of the associated symptoms, such as strange cravings or nausea. After years of talking indifferently about the possibility of having a child, when I had eventually thrown myself wholeheartedly into the process of attempted baby-making, our efforts had remained fruitless. The loss of my husband had totally devastated me. That, coupled with the untimely discovery of my pregnancy, had propelled me into a state of turmoil. A whole wave of emotions now washed over me. The baby would never know its father. And Graham, who had so desperately wanted to claim that role, would never be there to watch our child growing up. Plus, if I were to put hand on heart, I did not know how I would cope with rearing a baby on my own. I had always been a career girl, and the daunting prospect of single-handed responsibility for the welfare of a helpless infant threw me into a blind panic. I was a mess. "You really can't go on like this, Annie," Sarah had told me only the previous morning as she opened the curtains and attempted to restore some semblance of order to the train wreck that was once my living room. She turned her head to one side in that way of hers and looked at me, sympathy emanating from every pore. "You have to try to move on," she said gently. "I know it's hard, but you really need to get back to some sort of normality. He wouldn't want you to be so unhappy. You're still a young woman, and you've got to think of the baby, too." She had been right, of course. My sister, ever the voice of reason and practicality. We were so different in both appearance and nature. She, fair-haired and slight, like our mother, equable, ever the optimist. I had always been what our father had diplomatically described as well-built, my paternal genes leaving me narrow-waisted but short in stature and solid of limb, and darker in both colouring and temperament. I was definitely of the glass-half-empty school of thought, whilst Sarah always maintained that something positive could emerge from any situation if one allowed it to. Our parents, both suffering from arthritis, had retired and emigrated to Florida to escape the British climate, and were therefore too far away to offer much assistance. I was acutely aware that I had begun to lean heavily on my sister for support, and felt guilty about it. The least I could do was listen to her advice. I leafed through the brochure of holiday lets, which Sarah had well-meaningly brought to show me the other day, the slip of paper still clipped to the page that she had been so eager for me to see. It did look tempting. An old stone cottage with a wisp of smoke climbing from its chimney and roses woven into a trellis round the door. It was set a little way up a hillside on farmland in Anglesey, North Wales, surrounded by views of lush pastures and white-capped mountains. "It could be just what you need," she had said hopefully. "Peter has holidayed there on and off for years. His father's family were from the area, you know. He spent a couple of weeks there last August and said it was wonderfully restful. You have the cottage all to yourself, with the farmhouse right next door for home cooking, and company if you feel like it. Peter said the old farmer and his wife are a real tonic. Clean air, beautiful scenery. What more could you ask for? And Peter's even offering to drive you up there himself. I had paid little attention at the time, but maybe the Prozac was starting to kick in. Perhaps it was time to give myself a shake and get back to the real world. As if to reaffirm my thoughts, the baby delivered a sudden sharp kick into my ribs. I hesitated for a moment before picking up the telephone. Sarah, I've been thinking. Can you come over? I need to get in touch with Peter. Chapter 1. July 2009. And so it was that, on the first Sunday in July, I came to be a passenger in the car of my sister's friend and colleague, Peter, heading for what I hoped would hail the beginning of a fresh start for me. The doctor had warned me not to drive if the medication seemed to be affecting my judgment, and I did not as yet feel confident enough to get back behind the wheel, so I was relieved and grateful when Peter had offered to take me. The agreement was that he would be staying just the one night in the farmhouse itself, and then Sarah would join me in a few days' time and stay in the cottage for the remainder of the let, which had been booked for 3 weeks. I didn't know Peter particularly well. He had been working in the same office as Sarah for the past few months. We'd met only once or twice when she had brought him to the house. He was in his early 30s, of medium height and build, dark-eyed and handsome in a quirky sort of way. I found Peter pleasant enough and polite, but today, evidently having been briefed by Sarah about my state of mind, he seemed a little awkward about making conversation. I didn't mind. Still in that semi-anaesthetized state induced by the initial effects of the antidepressants, I welcomed the opportunity to sit back and watch as the flat, soulless terrain of the industrial Midlands, with its grey, suffocating factory chimneys and incessant traffic, gradually gave way to a vast expanse of clear sky with high, cotton-wool clouds and the undulating patchwork of fields of green and gold of the border country, peppered with sheep and cattle grazing contentedly. The gentle pitch of the hills and dales soon swelled into a majestically mountainous region of peaks and troughs as the landscape became wilder and more ruggedly beautiful. I had always enjoyed sketching and thought briefly what a wonderful picture the view would make. We crossed the imposing silver-grey suspension bridge that traversed the body of water separating the island from the mainland. I gazed down at the scene beneath us. The Menai Straits, dark but calm as a millpond, glittered in the late afternoon sun. Several small, colourful boats were moored at either side of its banks. They bobbed slightly with the gentle movement of the current. Numerous houses were staggered on the opposite embankment, their windows winking in the sunlight. Peter became a little more animated.
"Not far now. I'm so glad it's such lovely weather. It makes all the difference to the cottage, seeing it on a bright day. Not that it should matter," he added hastily. "It's just that, well, first impressions of a place can colour your judgment, don't you think?"
I felt the corners of my mouth twitching in amusement. He was clearly anxious for my approval of the house, since he had recommended it so gushingly to Sarah. Although their relationship was platonic, I suspected that Peter would like it to be rather more, but I knew that his feelings were sadly not reciprocated. Sarah had apparently long been holding a candle for some mystery man and showed no interest in anyone else. I often worried that she would finish up embittered and alone, although she seemed content enough with her lot. "I'm sure it'll be beautiful. The scenery looked breathtaking in the brochure," I said, smiling to myself. Smiling? For so long, it had felt as if I would never smile again. Sarah knew me better than I knew myself. A change of outlook always helps people see things from a different perspective, she had told me. It seemed she might well be right. I felt an increasing sense of anticipation as we drove across the island.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.